Welcome to First Baptist Church. I didn't know last night when we went to bed if we'd be here gathered outside this morning, but I'm thankful that the rain has passed and we have some good shade this morning, and it is a special day to be here at First Baptist Church, so we're glad that you've joined us for worship. Today's call to worship ties directly in with our first week of God's Story, Our Story. So listen along with this call to worship. It is Romans chapter 5, verses 17 through 19. If death ruled because of one person's failure, those who receive the multiplied grace and the gift of righteousness will even more certainly rule in life through the person Jesus Christ. So now the righteous requirements necessary for life are met for everyone through the righteous act of one person, just as judgment fell on everyone through the failure of one person. Many people were made righteous through the obedience of one person, just as many were made sinners through the disobedience of one person. The law stepped in to amplify the failure, but where sin increased, grace multiplied even more. The result is that grace will rule through God's righteousness, leading to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord, just as sin ruled in death.
Let's lift our hearts and our minds and our voices up to God in praise as we sing Joyful, Joyful We Adore Thee. It's number 7 in your hymnal. We'll sing stanzas 1 and 3. And I'm going to ask you to stand on this hymn and remain standing through our prayer.
Our time, all thine join me in the prayer this morning. Our Father and our God, we thank you for the privilege to gather in your sanctuary, the one you created. Thank you for holding back the clouds so that we could experience this 8 a.m. worship service. And thank you for the ministry of First Baptist Gainesville and the leadership of their pastor and staff and the lay leaders of this church. We believe there's a great future ahead. And thank you for honoring one of your long-term ministers who served so faithfully here and for all of us to have a part in that. We are grateful for the love and grace that comes to us through Jesus Christ our Lord and the privilege we have to serve him. We ask your blessings as we continue through this worship experience. In Jesus' name, amen. Be seated. I'm Larry Fields, Bruce's oldest brother, and I'm happy to be a part of this recognition of his 29 years of ministry at First Baptist Gainesville. I've enjoyed numerous times to be with the senior adult groups and senior adults, preaching here from time to time. Just a great experience, and have met many friends here. Thankful to be back on this special occasion. And thankful to Brother Jeremy for allowing me a few personal words after my invocation. I want to first of all confess my sin. And that is that Bruce and Nancy are not responsible. My niece and two nephews who grew up in Georgia Bulldog country are Tennessee fans. And I'm responsible because I invited them to many games in Neyland Stadium and they got hooked. So I'm thankful for that. But in confessing that, you need to be humble when you come into someone else's and be respectful. Notice the red shirt I have on. I would not dare bring that orange color into Gainesville. I wouldn't do that. But anyway, I did not have a very good first impression of Bruce Fields. I was in the fifth grade, and Dad took Mom across Lake Pontchartrain. We lived in Slidell. It was a little town of 5,000. It's a suburb of New Orleans today. But they had big hospitals there, but you had to carry, those days, you had to carry your wife over to New Orleans to birth the baby, and you didn't know until it popped out what you were going to get. And I already had a little brother and a little sister, and I could care less what I got, because I was interested in baseball, football, basketball, and girls at that time of my life. It so happened that Dad would call the principal and let us know how the birth went. And it came in about midday, and I was out on playing baseball with my friends. And two little girls came running from the principal's office, waving their hands, "Larry, Larry, Larry, your daddy just called, and you have a little red-headed brother." And I said, "Big hairy deal." Went back to playing baseball. So that was my first impression. But I must have been a prophet, because I submit to you that Bruce Fields has turned out to be a big deal. And I'm thankful for his 29 years of ministry at this church and look forward to worshiping. And another thing, I met Jerry Pesciuta about 3 years ago. And I thought, if we have some young men like that that can stay true to Baptist traditions and principles and applying the Word of God to missions and evangelism, we're going to be in good shape. And I cannot tell you how thrilled I was when Bruce shared with me, "Your new pastor, you're in good hands in the future, I believe, and I'll be praying for you. Thank you for giving me this privilege."
Brother Larry, thank you so much for, what's that? You can come to me, that'd be fine, sure. But stay six, I'm just kidding, no. Six. It's, you know, it's another strange day when there should be lots and lots of hugs on a day like today. And a few weeks ago when we were planning today's celebration, we knew that it may not be exactly what we want it to be, crowded in the banquet hall, telling stories, roasting Bruce, who knows, you know, all we would have done. But this is still a day of celebration. And I committed, you know, in the past week to stop calling this the bittersweet day. That's basically what I've been calling it for the past several weeks. This is such a bittersweet day, But today is just a day of celebration and thanksgiving. And I am personally, just having been here 5 months, I'm still so thankful for having known Bruce and Nancy for just a few months, and thankful for their ministry here and what they have meant to this church. Bruce's family, Bruce and Nancy's family, will be here in both services. We have some, obviously you've heard from Larry, but Andrew is over there as well, so good to see you. And then other members of Bruce's family will be here in the next service as well. But, and that's another thing, Bruce, I said, "Bruce, you know, which service do you want to do the recognition?" He said, "You know, let's do it in both services." And I'm glad that he said that, because we want everybody to be able to be here to celebrate Bruce and Nancy's final Sunday with us here at First Baptist Church. And so yesterday we had a drive-through celebration, not drive-by. Bruce kept saying, don't call it a drive-by, call it a drive-through, he said. And so we had a drive-through celebration yesterday in the South Portico. And from what I understand, for that entire 2 hours, there were people coming through and giving their thanksgiving for Bruce and Nancy. And so thank y'all for coming out yesterday in the heat and the humidity. And it looked like fun. And so thank you all for coming and sharing with them during that special time as well. And the family was there also for that. I'm going to say a little bit more about Bruce during my sermon. And I promise it's not about sin or anything like that. He's going to find his way into my sermon. But we do want to express our thanksgiving for Bruce and Nancy. And so as you were made aware, we want to thank you for contributing to this. We have collected, and Joe Cosper especially has been instrumental in helping us put this together, in putting together a book of letters and cards for Bruce and Nancy. And so we're going to present that to both of you now because we are so thankful, and we want you to know that personally. We can do, you know, all kinds of things as a church, but individually we want you to hear from us as well. So this album is full of letters and cards and words. Everyone here telling how much you mean to them and how much you've meant to us over these years. We want you to know it. This makes great reading material during sermons, and so I'm going to give it to you. The drill is, of course, you have to give it back after the service, because we'll do this again at 11. But we do want you to have this, and also in this is a gift from the church to let you know how much we appreciate you. So once again, let us give thanks to God and praise to God, and also thanks to Bruce and Nancy and family for these 29 years of incredible ministry at First Baptist Church.
Just overwhelmed with your generosity and your kind words and deeds, and I just wanted to begin with that we're just amazed. Thank you. I was listening to an Andre Crouch song yesterday, and it goes, I don't know why Jesus loved me. I don't know why he cared. I don't know why he sacrificed his life, but oh, I'm so glad he did. I don't know why in 1962, at 8 years of age, I just felt the need to ask Jesus in a little childlike prayer to come into my heart, and he did, and became my Lord and Savior. I don't know why he gave me a wonderful family in which to grow, wonderful grandparents and parents and older brothers and sister who loved me and prepared me for life. I'm just so glad he did. I don't know why 40 years ago when I met this lady, and I proposed to her, and she said yes, which was wonderful, and agreed to walk with me, beside me, in ministry. And I can assure you that I would not be the minister that I am without Nancy. And I'm just wanting you to know that, how grateful I am. I don't know why we were given the privilege of good-looking and talented children who love us, and we love them, but we're blessed. And of course, now, with a granddaughter. And that's part of the reason we want to retire, because we want to spend more time with her. And we want to travel, and we're going to do that. I don't know why God led us here 29 years ago, but I'm sure glad he did, because you people, through the years, have blessed us even more than we could ever bless you. And we are so grateful for that. Thank you for this day, as we begin a new chapter. Larry and I have a first cousin. He's in heaven now. His name was Wilmer C. Fields. We called him W.C. Fields for fun. He was a minister, and he often encouraged me in wonderful ways, phone calls, but especially letters. He was a great writer. And at the end of his letters, he would always write onward, not sincerely or yours truly or love. It was always onward, W.C. That's a good word for us as we prepare for retirement. And that's a good word for this church with Pastor Jeremy and our wonderful staff, who I will miss very much. And you people, you wonderful, generous, loving people. We will never, ever forget you. We're not leaving. We'll be around. We're just not going to be quite as visible as we once were. But you'll see us. And when we do, when we meet each other again, we will hug whatever way we can and encourage one another. So, I say thank you, God bless you, onward.
not only was Josephine Kosser instrumental in putting this book together of all of our letters, but she also gave us many, 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 many pictures that convey, that are over his 29 years of ministry. And our sound engineer, Ben Sellers, has put all that together in a beautiful video. And the soundtrack to the video is our choir singing, "Thank You for Giving to the Lord. I am a life that's been changed." This video is going to be available on our website and on YouTube beginning at 1 o'clock today. So I just want to let you know about that. I've already seen it, and it brought tears to my eyes. It was just wonderful. But plan to view that beginning at 1 o'clock or later at your convenience. The hymns we're singing today have all been picked out by Bruce. These are some of his favorites, and we're glad to be able to sing them today. Now we're going to sing "Oh How I Love Jesus," 217 in your hymnal. We'll sing stanzas 1 and 2.
Not raining, and we're so thrilled that you're here no matter what colors you're wearing. There is a wideness in God's mercy. We have so many things that are going on in this church this fall, and so many new things. And so if you are new to this church, or if you're not new to this church, I really encourage you to go to our website. And if you will scroll down from where the worship service is presented, you will find some fall leaves. And if you'll click on that emblem, you will find out about Bible studies, opportunities for all ages through music ministry, through Bible studies, and other fellowships. And so do that now, because there are new studies forming. And I know that this is a challenging time in many ways, but I'm telling you, the happiest people I know are growing spiritually, and they're finding ways to connect to other believers and to grow in their faith, and you will have many opportunities for that. There are also opportunities for service, and one of the biggest ones that is coming up will be our Emporium Bake Shop. We can't have our full-blown Emporium this year because of COVID-19, but we would really miss all of the wonderful things in the bake shop. And so if you have been and shopped there before, you know that this is high quality stuff. If you haven't already prepared to donate some baked goods that you have that you will make, please do that. It will be September 25th from 10 to 6 p.m. and September 26th from 10 to 3 p.m. So this is Friday and Saturday, and you will have the best time if you give baked goods that you've made, but you will also have the best time if you go buy some, and you can certainly put them in your freezer and have them for Thanksgiving. But more importantly, tell a neighbor, tell a friend. I challenge all of us to tell 10 people about the bake sale, because it's really word of mouth that'll get people here, and all of the proceeds will go to the Ministry of Caring. And I know that this season is one in which the Ministry of Caring will be called on many, many times to give aid to people in great need. So thank you to the ladies in our women's ministry, and please talk over here at the blue table. You can sign up there. Thank you, and I'd urge you to participate.
Please prepare your hearts to speak with God as your church prays together. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning. And as has already been said, it's another miracle that we can gather together in your presence and with one another to worship you. We thank you for your love, for your grace and mercy. We thank you for the standards you give us with the Ten Commandments and the way you work in our lives personally and privately to correct us, to mature us, to lead us to be better representatives of your kingdom and your world. Father, we ask your mercy and your healing on those who suffer now illness. We thank you for those that are with us even this morning who have recovered from difficult illnesses that plague our community now and other things. We celebrate their presence, and we know that you've brought them back to us because you have a new ministry and a future ministry in their lives. Father, thank you for the ministry you've given each one of us. But thank you especially this morning for Bruce and Nancy Fields, a couple that you called and led every year of their lives to be here to this moment today, which we celebrate with them. Thank you, Father, for the way they've connected us with one another and with you, and have been the special leaders that our church and each one of us needed each day of our lives here at First Baptist. Thank you, Father, that in Bruce's life and in Nancy's, you awakened in them a hunger for your Spirit, a desire to serve you, and the willingness to find out every step of the way what your next step was for them. And Father, we just celebrate with them this morning with that kind of sad but happy joy that we feel when we put a child on the bus or drop them off at school for the first time, when we let them go as they can pedal on their own on their bicycle, as they step forward to become the bride or the husband of some dear one you've let into their lives. And Father, that going and growing kind of joy is what we're definitely in touch with this morning. The kind of joy we know would not be complete if we held back and if we held on to them. And so, Father, we release them with love and to the next step in their lives, knowing that it's the next step in our church's life as well and in each of our lives as we move forward without them as immediate and present with us. And we do that, Father, especially with joy because we know that through Jesus Christ and his redeeming work on the cross and the promise that comes from the empty tomb, that we will not only see you again, but we will see them again and celebrate the joy that is made complete in eternity with you and them. And so, Father, we lift our voices together now as a church, repeating the words that Jesus taught us to pray when he said, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen."
Scripture teaches us that God's love endures forever, and to let the redeemed of the Lord say this. So let's celebrate God's love, and let's proclaim his redemption as we sing 531 in your hymnal, Redeemed. We'll sing stanzas 1 and 2.
Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, redeemed through
Are we celebrating Bruce's 29 years of ministry with us? We're celebrating his 40 years of ministry since his ordination. And he told me 40 years ago when he was ordained, this song was sung at his ordination, and he asked me that if I would share it with you today.
You to turn to our opening passage for this series, which is Genesis chapter 2 and verse 3. We'll be reading select verses from these two chapters that get to the heart of the story and where it begins. And so once again, if you'd like to follow along specifically, we'll be reading Genesis chapter 2 verses 4 through 9 and then verses 15 through 25. And then we'll read chapter 3, verses 1 through 8. On the day the Lord God made earth and sky, before any wild plants appeared on the earth, and before any field crops grew, because the Lord God hadn't yet sent rain on the earth, and there was still no human being to farm the fertile land, though a stream rose from the earth and watered all of the fertile land, the Lord God formed the human from the topsoil of the fertile land and blew life's breath into his nostrils. The human came to life. The Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east and put there the human he had formed. In the fertile land, the Lord God grew every beautiful tree with edible fruit. And also he grew the tree of life in the middle of the garden and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And verse 15 says, the Lord God took the human and settled him in the Garden of Eden to farm it and to take care of it. The Lord God commanded the human, eat your fill from all of the garden's trees, but don't eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, because on that day you eat from it, you will die. Then the Lord God said, it's not good that the human is alone. I will make him a helper that is perfect for him. So the Lord God formed from the fertile land all the wild animals and all the birds in the sky and brought them to the human to see what he would name them. The human gave each living being its name. The human named all the livestock, all the birds in the sky, and all the wild animals. But a helper perfect for him was nowhere to be found. So the Lord God put the human into a deep sleep and took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh over it. With the rib taken from the human, the Lord God fashioned a woman and brought her to the human being. The human said, this one finally is bone from my bones and flesh from my flesh. She will be called a woman because from a man she was taken. This is the reason that a man leaves his father and mother and embraces his wife and they become one flesh. The two of them were naked, the man and his wife, but they weren't embarrassed. The snake was the most intelligent of all the wild animals that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, did God really say that you shouldn't eat from the tree in the garden? The woman said to the snake, we may eat of the fruit of the garden's trees, but not the fruit of the tree in the middle of the garden. God said, don't eat from it and don't touch it or you will die. The snake said to the woman, you won't die. God knows that on the day you eat from it, that you will see clearly, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. The woman saw that the tree was beautiful with delicious food and that the tree would provide wisdom. So she took some of its fruit and ate it, and also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. Then they both saw clearly and knew that they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made garments for themselves. During that day's cool evening breeze, they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the Lord God in the middle of the garden's trees. Beginnings are important. It's not just where the story begins arbitrarily. They tell us something about the rest of the story and where we're headed and what we've got to deal with. I remember the first time the cat was let out of the bag that I was coming here to First Baptist Church. It was the day that I came to meet the staff on the Tuesday prior to my call Sunday. I remember arriving here on a gloomy, rainy day, not always the best weather you want on your first day that you meet people in your new congregation. It's better than a church I served about 10 years ago where there was a tornado on my first day. Now, this day was much better. I entered the church, I went to the sanctuary, and there were seats set up, spaced apart. There were no more than about a dozen of us in there, and it was the staff and a couple of other people. And of course, I was nervous to meet the staff. I'm sure that they were a little nervous to meet me as well. But immediately, there was someone who approached quickly, someone who wanted to put me at ease. Someone who said, Jeremy, we're so excited this day is here. We've been praying for you, even though you didn't know it, and we didn't know your name. We've been praying for you hard for these last months, and we're so glad this day is here. And he handed me his phone number, his wife's phone number, and said, if there's anything we can do to help you settle in, assuming the vote goes well this Sunday, of course, text or call, we'll be here for you. And of course, that was Bruce Fields. And so I will always, as I think about the beginning of my story here at First Baptist Church, I'll always think of that first day where I met the staff. And by the way, the rest of the staff was beautiful as well, don't get me wrong. But meeting Bruce put me at ease immediately. And I said, I've come to a special place. I've come to a place filled with grace and love and compassion that's coming through Bruce's introduction and hospitality for me. And I've quickly learned that that is how First Baptist Church is altogether. And I know that Bruce has had a lot to do with that because of his ministry and the way that he has taught us to show grace and love and hospitality to each other. So Bruce, thank you for being such a critical and vital and wonderful, there you are. I started looking out towards Nancy, you're back here. And Nancy as well, thank you for being such a wonderful part of the start of my story here at First Baptist Church. The beginning of the story is important. It establishes a reality. It establishes things that we have to look forward to as our story progresses. And so today, the opening of God's story is the opening of the grand story of creation. We read the Genesis 2 account today, which is prose. It's much more down to earth, pun intended, by the way. It's local. It's human focused. We approach this text with the poetic, cosmic text of Genesis 1, the creation of the cosmos in 7 days. And now we come down to the local place in which the human was created. At the beginning of the creation, God formed humankind. Yes, God formed Adam. God formed human. You'll notice the text I read today referred to it as the human or the human being, because that is exactly what Adam means. It can be a proper name, Adam, but it means the human. And the name Adam is actually related to and directly pulled from the word for earth or soil, Adama. And so we meet at the beginning of our story, God who creates the human from the humus, as some people might call him, or Adam. Adam had a relationship to God and to the earth in these opening verses. Adam was formed by God because God took from the soil, I can still picture my Old Testament professor forming the man with his fingers. There's the head, there's the arms, there's the legs. And then blowing life into Adam, the human. And so we already have two deep connections established in this creation story. Our connection to God and our connection to the earth, our deeply spiritual connection to the earth. Now, we're probably already hitting a snag where some of you might be saying, Pastor, don't bring in that new age stuff. I'm not connected to the earth. Well, yes, you are. You were formed from the earth and given the breath of God. We are deeply connected to all of creation. It's one of the truths established at the onset of the story. And yet we are not fully human until we receive the breath of God, the Ruach, the breath which brings us to life and makes us living beings. We are not just created matter. We are creatures with the breath of God. And next in the story, God takes this creature, Adam, or the human, and places Adam in the Garden of Eden to farm and to take care of it and to cultivate it. It is the first job hire in all of Scripture. There's a lot of firsts in this passage. It is the first job hire when God places the human in Eden to care for God's creation, to cultivate it and to care for it. And this makes sense in the story because this was a deeply agrarian society. This sense of cultivation and the stewardship of God's creation runs throughout God's law in the Old Testament. All work is to be seen as cultivation, as tilling, as creating and making fertile soil in the creation. In this garden, God also notices that Adam can't do it on his own. God sees that the human shouldn't be alone and creates animals, and still it is not enough. God's handiwork continues because human needs a special kind of helper. God's handiwork continues, some might say, finds its culmination in the creation of woman. Amen? I thought that would go over. For the sake of understanding the story, however, we should consider this word helper. We should pause and consider the word helper. A few weeks ago, we heard of a misuse of Scripture where one pastor said that it is ordained in the Scripture that woman should not have the right to vote. And my guess is that pastor may have looked to the Genesis passage and said, see, woman is just helper. Woman takes no initiative. But the very translation of this word, help, should be considered in light of how else it is used in the Scripture. The word helper, this very word, is also used in Psalm 33 when the psalmist says, God, you are my what? You are my helper and deliverer. And so helper in this case is not intended to be a subservient role. It is a fulfilling, completing presence. In order to fulfill the task of caring for the garden and creation, woman is given, and the first human community is formed. It is a community of love and compassion, help, sharing in each other's burdens. But the story takes an unfortunate turn towards what we call the fall. That is the title of today's sermon, Creation and Fall. But I'm not always sure fall is the right terminology. My daughter Macy falls about 5 times a day. It's an accident. She did not rebel when she fell. It may be better to call this creation and disobedience, or creation and rebellion. Because in Genesis 3, both woman and man rebel against God's instructions and commands and limitations. In this beautiful, full creation, look around us, we're given all of this. God gives us limitations, and the humans can't comprehend it. The serpent, who is cunning and slithery, convinces Eve to eat, and then Eve tells the man to eat. And altogether, we've downplayed God's command to set limitations for ourselves and the ways that we act in creation. This seemingly innocuous act of eating a piece of fruit is the sin entering the world through greed, disobedience, rebellion, and deception. It's all there. There are probably many more that we could draw into this moment. Professor Jacqueline Lapsley said, this is the moment humankind chose to be human-centered rather than God-centered. God had created the cosmos, the earth, the plants, the animals, humankind. We enjoyed such sustenance, such abundance, such blessing, but it wasn't enough. We said, I've got to have more. God, you have not satisfied me. I've got to have more. What you've given us, God, is not enough. I've got to have more. And so I'm going to take matters into my own hands in order to obtain more. Creation and fall, the beginning of God's story. I think the real challenge here is when the serpent says an often glossed over phrase, you will be like God. You will be like God. The challenge and the tension is that we are created by God. We have the breath of God. We are created in the image of God, and yet there are limitations. We are, in fact, not God. Something we must remind ourselves of every day. It's a presence that tempts us with the very notion that you can be God. We have the ability and the power to create and use our hands and cultivate and work. And so before long, we say, hey, I'm a godlike creature. God says, no, you have limits. There are boundaries which you must respect. the central character of God's story, as we've said these previous few weeks, is our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And this reminds me of a story when Jesus is taken up on the mountain and is faced with his greatest temptation by Satan, a slithery presence with the Savior, and says, "You can have all of this." In many ways, it's the same temptation that Adam fell for in this creation narrative. And yet Jesus says, "Away from me, Satan. It is written, worship the Lord and serve him only." And so there's our answer to where the story goes wrong. There's our answer to the fall and to the rebellion. Reading the creation story through a Jesus lens is ripe with meaning. But today's lesson tells us that together as God's creation and as God's community, when we serve God only, we will flourish in the creation that God has gifted us with. There's a few truths we can take from today's passage. First and foremost, we are the handiwork of God. Someone may need to hear that today. From the cosmos and to the trees, to the livestock, and to the humans, God made it. And so from the onset, and even today, we are in an intimate, loving relationship with God. God is not an angry, distant deity. God forms us with his own hands. God breathes life into each and every one of us. We are here because a loving God formed us and created us. Genesis 1 states a theological truth when God sees that it is good. In Genesis 2, that is self-evident. It paints a raw picture of the loving act of creation. God also intends for us to work. I think we sometimes perceive the Garden of Eden as the Atlanta Botanical Gardens. It's like a place to go and to find leisure, to relax, to take a vacation. Oh, I'm longing for the day when we can return to Eden so I can relax and not work anymore. No, Eden is a place of work. It is the ideal economy. Its work yields fruit, it sustains, and the work continues. We are called to work in God's economy. No matter what kind of economy our world or our culture or our nation chooses to enact, we are called to work in God's economy. The work that is given to us by God is beneficial for all. It blesses all. It serves all. Our work is for the benefit of all people and not just ourselves. And therein lies our challenge today. Work is often seen as the money maker. What benefits us? But true work is ministry. Sometimes people tell me, "I'm in the Lord's work." And yeah, I am definitely in the Lord's work as your pastor of First Baptist Church. But you're also in the Lord's work. That is not a title that reserved for pastors or ministers. Everyone here is called to the Lord's work of using our hands and our strength and our resources to create shalom in our communities. Whether you are employed or out of work, or a stay-at-home mom or dad, whether you live in a monastery or one of the largest metro areas in the country, whether you are young, old, male, or female, we are intended to cultivate this God-given creation with compassion and love. That is your job. And it is a job that you never leave or retire from, is it, Bruce Fields? We need help. The creation story tells us that we need community. God gave humankind so much at the outset of creation, and yet it wasn't enough. We need a helper. God's creation depends on healthy community, which means caring for each other and helping each other. This story speaks of the first man and woman, which recognizes the marriage union as foundational. But I think this means something much bigger, because not everyone is married. There are also those who were called to singleness or other paths in life. And so I think this shows us, ultimately, that no human can exist in isolation, that we all need helpers. We are made complete in a covenant community with others. I think in the coming months, as the daylight becomes less and less and it gets colder, and we enter this winter facing a pandemic, we may feel this sense of loneliness more than ever. We may feel a loneliness that Adam felt in those opening verses. Even now, we recognize our need for community. And so we will pursue that as a church, no matter where the next few months takes us in light of this pandemic. We also need saving from ourselves. God is over the story. God is the center of the story. And yet we make it about us. That is the challenge that we take with us as we close the scripture today. We are challenged weekly with a truth that we have created, that the story is about us. Donald Miller in Blue Like Jazz says, "The most difficult lie I have ever contended with is this: life is a story about me." Life is not a story about me. Life is a story about the created order under God's leadership. One of the reasons we're calling this God's story, our story, and not God's story, my story, is because life is too often about me. That's what got us in trouble in the first place. But God creates us amidst the creation with His breath and with Jesus at the forefront of what we do. The one who was there with God in the beginning. We can deny the temptation to make this story all about me. And we can live into the story of a loving God and a God who calls us to love our neighbor as ourselves. And it is in that we find joy in the story. So let's enjoy God's creation as God intended us to do. Let's go to work. Let's be blessed in community. Let's work together to make our story God's story. Let's pray together. God, we give thanks for inviting us into this story. We give thanks for your beautiful creation. We pray that as we go about our lives and enter into Christian work, no matter what that looks like, that we would be ready to cultivate and to create fertile soil around us. Remind us that fertile soil is all about compassion and grace and mercy and love that is seen most clearly in the main character of the story, who is Jesus Christ. May his life, death, and resurrection be the model for us all as we seek to live our story in this city and across the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
As our hymn of commitment, let's sing together 282. We'll sing the first stanza of Living for Jesus. Just hold on a second.
For joining us for worship today at First Baptist Church. If there are guests or visitors here today, Please don't rush out. Come see one of the staff. We'd love to meet you before you head out today. Just as a reminder, we're thankful for your gifts and continued support of First Baptist Church. I would say that there are baskets here to collect those in, but I'm not seeing them. So I will just make a plug for our online. If you would like to give online, we welcome you to do that. You can visit our website, and you can certainly give to the church through those means. And of course, we have our secure drop box at the side of the church that you're welcome to leave your tithe or offering in as well. So thank you again for that. As always, once again, check our Facebook website for any changes and events that are coming up here at First Baptist Church. We're so glad that you joined us for worship today. Hear now these words from the book of Romans as our benediction, and then we'll be dismissed. May the glory be to God, who alone is wise. May the glory be to him through Jesus Christ forever. Amen.
Better.